and welcome to the Total Soccer Show. My name is Daryl Grove, and I'm joined by a man who's been watching the Women's World Cup with me. His name is Taylor Rockwell. Hello.
Hello.
You don't sound so happy.
I'm mad.
Is this because of the Scotland
Come
game?
On, Scotland.
So you do not have Scottish heritage?
I have a little bit.
You have a little bit?
Yeah.
I'll bet I've got more than you.
I mean, again, I go back to my grandfather on my mother's side being Wallace Randolph.
Oh, maybe you have more than me. So the main game we watched together in studio was England-Scotland.
Yes.
But over the last 2 days,
I took my Rangers jersey off halfway through.
You did. I kept my England jersey on. It's still here.
To be fair, the air conditioning wasn't on at the time, so I feel like I was justified in taking off my, 1990s polyester long-sleeve Rangers jersey.
You can tell we stand in a better mood than when we did the USA Venezuela review.
A little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Because the Women's World Cup has been more fun than watching the US get dismantled by
it
Venezuela.
It was until you mentioned it, and now I'm sad again.
Well, let's forget about it again.
All right.
All right. So England Scotland was a big game we watched, but we have 6 games to look back at over Saturday and Sunday.
It's the last game to get to chronologically, which
is
how we're doing this.
Okay. So let's start Saturday morning, our time. Germany, China.
Yep.
Germany struggled. I'm going to say this. I think China came out in it looked like a sort of 4-4-2 compact, tight defensive block. And Germany said, how about we just send in endless crosses?
Yeah.
That'll work.
This did look about how I thought it would look for maybe the first half an hour. And then I did expect Germany, given their dominance and their kind of depth that they have, that I figured they would figure things out a little bit more, because I did the China preview. I expected them to sit very deep and then kind of counter through a couple players, but not necessarily look to send a bunch of numbers forward.
Yeah.
So it felt to me like
Wang Shuanshan and Wang Shan is who you expected to counter.
Yeah, and so
only one of which started.
I know. I was surprised by this. But I think Shuanshan came on eventually.
Yeah.
But it still was just surprising to me, because I expected Germany to kind of expect China to be very deep and have plans for breaking them down or pulling them out.
And I thought we'd see Jennifer Marisan do her sort of misdirect passing, open teams up kind of thing.
Yeah.
And she just bought in on the, let's keep crossing it, Alexandra Popp will just get on the end of one eventually. That seemed to be the plan.
That was disconcerting.
It was,
if
right?
you're a Germany fan, I would say as disconcerting, or maybe more so, is how susceptible they seemed to getting into little altercations with Chinese players.
Yeah.
Which, not to say that, like, you should just be, like, you know, proper and not get into, like, any sort of physical arguments or whatever, but more so that that's clearly a tactic that the Chinese players are trying to be physical. They're trying to not give the ball.
They
They're trying to knock you off your game.
Exactly.
Because once they can, if they can bump you off your rhythm, that's definitely ideal for them. But then also, if they can take you out of the game by making you focus on the physicality and focus
mentally,
on the infractions, then you're not focused on finding a way through.
I think that is what happened.
Exactly.
And Germany is somewhat not lucky, because it was a good strike from Gwyn, right?
It was.
Who eventually, it's a shot from the top of the box, I think, after a corner.
Mm-hmm.
It's a nice goal. But I could easily see another version of this game where it ends 0-0 and the Germans are super frustrated at the end.
Yes, that is true. That said, when the U.S. women won in 2015, it started off slow for them. And it was a sort of, and this is kind of one of those things where against a very defensive team who have talent, who can easily be overlooked if you're not prepared for them,
China?
This easily could have been 0-0. It could have been 1-0 to China if Germany got kind of overly confident or sent numbers forward or played a little bit too open. So
I did worry there were a couple of Chinese chances that weren't taken that made me think maybe Germany's centre-backs are not the strongest part of their team.
We shall see.
Yeah.
First game is early, but
I'll take your point that essentially they came up against a bunkered opponent and they got a 1-0 win, and that's basically all you can ask for to start a World Cup.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah. I mean, unless you wanted to ask for 2-0, in which case you could ask for that too.
It's the minimum that you can ask for, and they met that minimum and they're off to a decent start. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And now how did you feel about who was your Magal? I always want to say her Maguli, but it's not. It's Magal.
Lina Magal.
Magal.
Lina Magal. She didn't start.
She did not.
I think De Brits maybe started over her. Magal came on for, I think she's called Leobals, who was like the number 6, like deepest holding midfielder. I don't think Magal changed the game, but I don't think it's a coincidence that after she came on, Gwyn scored.
There we go.
I am team Magal. I think she should be starting for Germany. She has energy. She goes box to box. She's feisty. I think she's kind of a lot of the things that Germany were lacking in the first hour or so.
And you had an exchange with Kate Margraff about this, right?
Well, basically just that I tweeted it, and Kate Margraff, who I really respect her sort of tactical analysis at this World Cup and in soccer in general, basically agreed. She said, you beat me to it by 20 seconds. But then her tweet was much more layered and had a lot more detail about what Magal would bring to the game.
I mean, I wasn't going to say it, but that's fine.
I feel like you were.
Well done, Kate. Sort of well done, Daryl.
And sort of well done, Germany.
Yeah.
1-0. All right. Spain, South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Spain got the 3-1 win.
Which I was a little nervous, I'm not going to lie, because I had predicted, I did the South Africa preview, and I was excited about aspects of them. I was excited about Kakatlana. She was one of the players I highlighted. But I had said before this game in our like France-Korea review and then looking at a couple games to come, I said, this feels like one of those games that's going to finish 3-0 to Spain, and we're going to come out of it and people are going to be saying like, ooh, Spain might really be a contender. And South Africa went ahead 1-0, and I was like, I'm going to hear about this at the end of the day.
But it finished 3-1.
It did.
So Spain get the win to open Group B, and mostly through penalties.
Yes.
Right? So there's a late goal that South Africa concede from open play. But the equaliser and the go-ahead goal for Spain.
You sound so sad. You sound so sad, my friend.
Well, I just feel like both penalties were sort of unfortunate but accurate.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a fair description of both penalties?
It's the worst, but yes, it is.
So the Van Wyck, I think we're pronouncing it Van Wyck like Seinfeld, but I think it's pronounced Van Wyck.
Yeah.
The handball, I've forgotten who the Spanish player that's crossing it in. Van Wyck turns her back, lifts her arm up, a bit DeAndre Yedlin-ish. Like we criticized him in the Copa America for it. You just can't do it.
No.
You can't turn and raise your arm because it's the whole like you're outside the silhouette. It's in a natural position, et cetera, et cetera. You've got to kind of stand up and not have your arms out.
Yeah, I mean, this is definitely not rules of the game at all. First of all, like it hit her elbow.
Yeah.
That's going to be a penalty on VAR. I mean, that's like we had some people asking about that. That seemed like, it's the way it's going to be called.
Wasn't this called straight away, though?
Yes.
Yeah?
Because
that's checked on VAR.
Because the other reason why I do think that, to your point about Yedlin, is like once you turn your back, once you turn your kind of face and lift that arm, you can't argue like, oh, I'm in a natural position and I'm trying to defend the ball.
Yeah.
If anything, you look like you're kind of flailing about. And so even if she wasn't, even if it seemed harsh, that's always going to be given as a penalty.
And I'll bet the distance from which it hit her was pretty close, but not quite close enough to say that she's not at fault.
Yeah.
Right? Because they do take distance into account. If it's like a millimeter from you, you get away with it. It was just enough separation before it hits her arm, right? Or elbow.
They definitely take distance. Yes. They definitely take distance into account. I do also wonder if they take like velocity into account, because it's worth noting here that this was more of a like chipped ball across the box than it was like a driven shot. And again, I think if it's a driven shot and you maybe have
less
the arm,
reaction time.
Yeah, I think so. Then that probably gets factored into it.
Oh, okay. And Jennifer Hermoso steps up, scores the penalty, looks very happy, obviously, because this would have been a terrible result for Spain, right?
Yes.
Because they obviously wanted to open with a win.
Yes.
And then there's the other penalty.
Then there's the other penalty.
It's Vilakazi. Mm-hmm. It's a foul on Garcia. She essentially, Vilakazi clears the ball and then, in my opinion, follows through and gets her cleats into Garcia's thigh. Mm-hmm. And that's reckless. That's a yellow card. That's why she's sent off, right?
Yep.
It's a second yellow. And unfortunately, it's a foul.
Yes.
Even though she was clearing the ball. I feel really bad about this, but I also feel it's accurate.
Mm-hmm.
I feel bad as in South Africa are hard done by, but also rules are the rules.
Yes.
Laws are the laws.
I think this is one where I also think some of the analysis of this one didn't help, because the way I saw this one being debated by the Fox like studio crew was there intent there? Like, does she leave the studs in? Is she trying to put studs into the player?
Uh-huh.
Or is she just trying to clear the ball? And I don't think it's really either one of those. I think the reality is she's trying to clear the ball, but in so doing, her studs make contact with an opposition player.
Yep.
They didn't necessarily need to. That's dangerous. That's reckless.
It's reckless.
It's going to be a card.
If it was dangerous, it would be straight red.
Excuse me.
Right?
Yeah, it's reckless. Yeah, and by the rules of the game, that's what it's going to be. Mm-hmm. So, and not necessarily the rules. Not saying reckless is in there, but you get my point. So I think, she goes into it. And this is not really dissimilar from what we've seen in the past of a player trying to clear the ball and not seeing the attacker running through it instead of clearing, hitting the attacker. Even if she didn't mean to do that, even if she didn't mean to make the contact, she still does. So it's still going to be a foul, and it's in the box, so it's going to be a penalty.
Jennifer steps up again. Mm-hmm. Jennifer Hermoso, Jenny as they call her, 2-1.
As you called her, right? She was one of your players that you spotlighted, I believe.
Yes, absolutely, yeah.
I
mean, she's Spain's main striker, right?
Yes.
Lucia Garcia, does get that third goal.
Mm-hmm.
This is some not good South African defending.
I know
it's hard with 10 players, right?
But I mean, and I think when you've held on for as long as they did and you've kind of carried it the second half, and then even up until what, the 83rd minute, early 80s, I think is when Spain take the lead.
83rd minute is the second penalty.
Yeah, and so I think even up, like, you've held on, even we're a player down, and then you go like a goal down. I think at that point, you're forgiven a little bit for maybe switching off, maybe just feeling like, oh,
well,
that was
the worst
our
chance. Part is, I actually don't know which player it was, because I'm not sure of the configuration of the back line at this point, because they've lost their left back, right? Because Vilakazi was the left back. But somebody is like 15 yards deeper than the rest of the defensive line.
Yep.
This is what allows Lucia Garcia to run.
Yes.
3-1 to Spain in Group B.
And it's worth noting here, because I do think South Africa, like, because of their minnow relative minnow status. Like, yeah. People were rooting for them, wanted to see them get their first win. And it's I saw people tweeting, like, oh, it's such a shame South Africa didn't get their first win. Always wanted to see a team get their first win. It's like, this was Spain's first win at a World Cup. Like, give credit where credit's due. They fight back and get the win.
And to give you a quick update on the, on the standings, Spain are top of Group B because they scored, they got a plus two goal difference. Germany only have the plus one. So it's Spain, Germany, China, South Africa right now.
Mm-hmm.
All right, back to Group A. France beat Korea handily Friday. We did a whole separate review of that. You can find it in our feed. The second game in Group A was the final game on Saturday. Correct me if I'm wrong. I'm kind of freewheeling it here.
You got it.
Norway, Nigeria. Mm-hmm. Here's what. So I only saw highlights of this. Here's what I saw. I saw your preview come true.
All right.
Your preview was Norway will press like a swarm of locusts and make it impossible for any team to play out. They'll win the ball off you and they'll score.
All right. That's
basically
good to know.
What happened for this game.
Because do you want to know what I saw for briefly?
That?
Nothing. Because...
Oh, Fox Sports 2.
Yes. I got some beef. I got some beef with our Fox friends.
Okay.
Can I do this now? Can I mean, do...
Yeah.
All right. I appreciate that they've made it possible to get as many of the games as we can on television. I appreciate that we can stream. I don't appreciate that there's things like when we try to watch games now and we get the, this event has ended, you cannot watch.
So yeah, under replays, we know the event has concluded.
Yes.
That's why we're on the replay section. Mm-hmm. Make it available.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And then I think my digital package allows me to. I'm not sure why, but for some reason they would not let me access Fox Sports 2 on my Apple TV. So instead, it tried to make me watch Indy Racing, I believe it was. Might have been NASCAR.
It's not even half as good.
It's really not. And also, it was...
It's faster, but it's not as good.
It was telling because I was watching... we were watching from home yesterday, and I was watching like in the bedroom where the TV is. My wife was studying at her desk, and she went from like really enjoying the kind of background ambient noise of soccer to like, what is happening? Because suddenly it was loud racing, and it was not what she was going for. Yes, so...
Well, here's what I can tell you about Norway and Nigeria.
Oh, I mean, I did eventually see it. It's just, it was the first 15 minutes of frustratingly trying to figure out how to see it.
So the very first goal... It's Reiter gets the credit for the goal.
Yep.
It's kind of almost an own goal off of the defender. But it's really all about Caroline Graham Hansen.
Okay.
Who you did feature in the preview.
Yes.
You did say, watch out for her dribbling.
Yeah.
But I think you followed it up with she also misses some penalties. And people only heard the penalties part.
I saw her miss two penalties in the clips that I saw. And to me, that was enough. And the other thing I noticed is that she keeps taking them even when she misses them. So,
so confident.
She'll score some, but she'll miss some too.
So,
but also is very good.
This goal is really worth watching because Caroline Graham Hansen, the number 10 for Norway, dribbles at Akobi, who is more of an attacking midfielder for Nigeria, straight from a corner kick, which is normally you don't get very far. I don't have much analysis of this, except she just faints one way, goes the other, and Akobi buys it. And then Caroline Graham Hansen is suddenly at the end line and able to play that cutback.
My assumption here is that Akobi is standing inside the box. Caroline Graham Hansen is not. And I think Akobi is maybe very aware that an aggressive challenge could be a penalty. And I think she doesn't want to commit, but she doesn't want to get beat, but she doesn't want to allow for a cross. And while she's trying to factor all those things in, she gets beat.
Yep. And that's 1-0 Norway pretty early on.
Yes.
The second goal is, I think, more illustrative of your Norway swarm-like locusts kind of point, because they essentially pressure Nigeria. Nigeria clear it. And as they clear it, Norway come through and win the ball again.
Yeah, I mean, I would say even the initial pressure makes the clearance somewhat haphazard.
Yes,
so it's not even
it's not a
60-yard clearance or 50-yard clearance. It's maybe 20, maybe 30 yards. And then again, Norway are on it very fast.
And it's picked off by Reiter again. Yeah. Gives it straight to Utland, who smashes it. I think she aims like center top.
I think she aims for keeper face is what she aims for. She hits that ball so hard. Like, there's no aim to it. She's just like, I'm just going to hit this as hard as I can on the volley.
Yeah.
But it does have, like, because she hits it so hard and so well, it does have, like, the knuckle and the swerve and the dip that makes it really difficult to stop.
Yeah.
It's also a smashed volley from about 12 yards out, which makes it doubly hard to save.
And soon after, so all inside the first
half.
But
I enjoy the just hands up. Don't move celebration.
Yeah,
clearly meant quite a little bit to score that goal. Yeah.
So less happy was the next goal scorer.
Yeah.
It was an own goal from O'Hale. I'm going to call it. O'Hale, maybe?
Yeah.
O'Hale. I actually can't remember what happens in the build-up to this, but I'm going to assume there's a Norway press involved.
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's basically just Norway trying to put, trying to get bodies in there, trying to swarm, trying to cause problems for Nigeria. And then I think it's a cross in, and it just gets turned into the goal. And it's unfortunate for Nigeria, but it's more representative of kind of the game as a whole.
Yeah, there we go. So that's definitely a thing to look out for, is Norway will continue that press. And it'll be interesting when it comes up against France in Group A. Right?
I will say that I spotlighted Herlofsen, the forward for Norway.
Yes.
She's the one who puts the shot cross what have you, in that gets turned into the goal. So
I'm going to say she's looking for Utland, right?
Yeah, and I think so. Therefore, Herlovsen gets the credit, and my prediction is so far so good.
We're not playing the prediction game.
Actually, I didn't make a prediction. I just said watch her. So in that regard, I stand by that statement.
Watch her on
Continue
TV.
Continue to watch Herlovsen.
So Group A standings are France atop, yes, 3 points and a +4 goal differential. Norway a second.
What's the difference?
3 points
there?
And +3.
I know that's ironic.
One's British and one's American.
Okay, is goal differential British?
American.
Okay. Yeah. I grew up
saying goal difference, and over here people say goal differential, and I sometimes slip into it.
Okay. I think I almost wrote that twice yesterday, and then I was like, wait, is it different? Okay, I don't even know what to do anymore. So I just gave up.
So then you've got Nigeria in third and South Korea in fourth, obviously, because they let in 4 goals.
Yes.
Oh. Three more games to talk about.
Yep.
But first, today's show is sponsored by FBref.com, footballreference.com. It's a new site from sports reference people who've done all kinds of other sports with all kinds of stats. Now they've got football at FBref.com. And specifically, they have the Women's World Cup. They have all kinds of Women's World Cup stats.
They do indeed. They have, for example, the leaderboards for goals, assists, goals and assists, as well as yellow cards. Daryl, can you guess who is top of the table right now in terms of goals scored? Who's leading the Golden Boot race?
So Wendy Renard has 2. Bonacieux has 2. Jennifer Amoso has 2.
There is still one leader.
Someone with more?
I'll give you a hint. We have not yet talked about her, but we're about to.
I don't know. Oh, Cristiane,
the
hat-trick.
There you go.
I'm so dumb. How did I forget the hat-trick?
You know, these things happen.
Brazil's Cristiane has a hat-trick.
She does indeed, yes. But I'm more impressed that you were able to just knock out everybody who has a brace so far. Well done, my friend.
Yeah, Bonacieux has the offside goal as well, so maybe she deserves at least an asterisk.
I think she does. She's like, she's 1B. Yes, yeah. Exactly.
Have you got the assist leaders, or should we do another day?
It looks like it's only one player right now who's top of the charts.
And who's that?
I mean, if Cristiane is the golden boot winner right now.
Oh, number 7. I forgot the name. Andrea Alves.
I can't give you credit unless you get the full name. There it is. He got it in the end.
Number 7, Andrea Alves has 2 assists.
Did you look at something? I feel like you looked at something.
I looked inside my mind.
I like the slow evolution of Andrea to Andressa to Andressa Alves. Well done,
least,
my friend.
Yeah, it was better than the Berhalter system, right? It progressed and got better each time.
I'm not even going to ding you for not saying Da Silva. So there you go.
Thank you very much. I subscribe to the Stathead newsletter via fbref.com, which if you go to the website, you can click and subscribe to the newsletter. I have in front of me average age of teams ranked. Can you guess I know that you know the oldest team, right?
Yeah.
The oldest team in the tournament by average age is the United States. Average age of 28.6. But we looked into this.
That is more surprising than I thought it would be. Not that they're the oldest, but that it's 28.6.
Why?
Because I would have thought
28.5.
I would have thought closer, like 26 or 27 would have been the average out. But I guess you do have a number of players who are at like 33 to 35. I think Carly Lloyd 36. So I guess that makes
Krieger's
more sense.
Krieger's 34.
Yeah.
And there's no like youth, right? Even Mallory Pugh is now in her 20s,
yes,
right?
Yes. Yeah, I think Tierney Davis in 2021, and then I think Mallory Pugh 21 as well.
So is this a thing to worry about, or does this just mean that we've basically got a bunch of experienced players and that's who's on the roster?
I'm not worried about it right now.
Second oldest team?
Next World Cup, maybe.
Second oldest team with an average age of 28.4 is Brazil. I think it's mostly Formiga in her 41 years. But also they've
got probably Marta as well.
There's a lot of players who've been around for a while. Yeah. Right? Can you guess the youngest team in the tournament?
Jamaica?
It's Jamaica. Average age, 23.1. And I would argue,
start a teenager in goal, that'll happen.
We're going to talk Brazil-Jamaica later on. You could kind of see the age difference. So the second oldest team in the tournament versus the youngest, you could see the experience versus the inexperience. Right?
But you can see all of that, all of those stats, all of those numbers we just talked about at fbref.com, fbref.com. Thank you very much to them for sponsoring today's episode.
Who is that? fbref.com.
That's correct.
That's where people should go.
Football Reference. If you want to spread it all out, there you go.
Okay, let's move on next to a game that I discovered this morning. I have an internal Women's World Cup alarm clock.
Do you really?
I didn't set an alarm. I woke up at 7:03 a.m. Eastern Time, made a quick cup of tea, and I was in my seat to watch Australia, Italy. And I'm glad I did, because this was a really good game.
So you went just tea? No breakfast, just tea?
It was too early to eat.
Okay.
Also, honestly, post-chemotherapy, a little queasy, got to ease into the day.
All right. Yeah. And we're going black tea here?
No, a bit of milk.
Okay.
Yeah, a bit of whole milk in there and some stevia.
But black tea with milk, though.
I'd like to talk about the game, mostly. Australia, Italy. This is the first upset of the tournament.
I was wondering how long I could keep it going.
Quite longer than expected, I think. I hope people are still listening. Australia,
what
Italy.
What kind of stevia?
This is the first upset of the tournament. Kroger's own brand. A late winner from Bonacieux makes it 2-1 to Italy, 95th minute. Australia one of the sort of maybe, not favorites, but like we expect
they're
them
up
to
there.
Go far.
Yeah, exactly.
We expect them to beat Italy. Mm-hmm. They did not.
They did not. Yeah. And I'm with you. That is a massive result, not just for Italy, I believe, also getting their first result at a Women's World Cup, mm-hmm. But because Australia seemed like they were in a strong position heading into this one. They obviously have the depth of talent, and then they obviously have Sam Kerr, who does get her name on the score sheet. But certainly,
and that's even the weirdest thing, right? You would think if Sam Kerr scores and it's 1-0, that like that's Australia are off and running, and everything's going to be fine for Australia.
Especially if you made it even more misleading, and you said Sam Kerr scored from open play, and Australia also got a penalty that was taken by Sam Kerr. You'd be a little bit more confused, I think.
So let's talk about this first goal then. It's 1-0 mm-hmm. to Australia in the first half because Carpenter, one of our favorite players, I think, mm-hmm. Raiding right back is what I call her, Ellie Carpenter, gets down the right, whips a cross in. Sam Kerr is, I think, kind of making a run to the near post to go and meet it. And Gamma, the Italy captain, gives away a penalty kick. And I think, again, this is an even more obvious penalty kick than the South Africa ones.
It is.
Because she's just grabbing Sam Kerr's jersey.
Yes, exactly. And it's a credit to referee Borjas, I think is her last name, that she's in position. If you watch it, as soon as the cross is delivered, she is maybe 10 yards away and is just staring at this. Because I think it's very obvious it's going to Sam Kerr. I think you're absolutely right that she's basically made a run to the near post, but sort of is trying to make a run to the near post, I should say, because she's fainted like she's going back post. And that's where I think Gamma kind of steps across.
So she gave Gamma the slip of like far post, near post.
Exactly.
It's a classic run, right? So Sam Kerr, I assume, is really good at this stuff.
I would assume so. So I think that then Gamma's trying to make up that play, just get a little bit of the jersey, but she grabs both sides of the jersey simultaneously and definitely pulls back.
Is that the mistake? Do you think maybe you can pull one side and it's like obscured from the referee's view and you get away with it? And especially, I see a lot of players grab one side but then let go. You know what I'm saying? So it's never like I got a full grip.
Yes, I do think that. I also think that maybe that's something that the officials in this World Cup have been told to keep an eye on more so
jersey
than maybe
grabbing?
We knew. Yeah, because I think it's in Australia. Yeah, the late winner for Italy off the free kick, which we'll get to later, like that comes about from an infraction.
Oh, it's arm grabbing.
It's arm grabbing, but it didn't seem that severe. It's not like the player falls over or anything like that. So I think maybe they're just policing the pulling of jerseys a bit more. I saw that in the Germany-China game as well, that there was a few instances where the Chinese players seemed very frustrated by the call being given, but it's given just because there was a little bit of a tug. And I think if they think that infringes on the ability to run at all, then that foul is getting called.
Okay, yeah, that's fair. Sam Kerr steps
up. Yes.
The penalty is saved.
Mm-hmm.
Sam Kerr scores the rebound.
She does.
She does. Mm-hmm. And then she punches the corner flag.
And then she does that too. And then celebrates with her team. It's a lot she of does. Sam Kerr moments here.
It is. And it really felt like, here we go, Australia away. They're going to probably like win this 2-3-0.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I've forgotten the centre-back's name. Is it Pilkinghorn?
Polkinghorn, yeah.
Polkinghorn, excuse me. Pilkington is our friend.
I've been calling her Polkinghorn because the R and the N in tiny font pressed together looks like an M, but it's Polkinghorn.
Polkinghorn. So Australia, essentially, are passing the ball around the back. Italy are in their like, weird 4-4-2-ish shape, putting like light pressure on, right? Like they're quite high up the field, but they're not really pressuring the ball. And I think Polkinghorn is kind of a little bit casual. She's the right centre-back. As she receives it, she takes one of those touches that you see centre-backs take where they push the ball ahead of themselves to advance play up the field. Mm-hmm. And I think you spotted this. It's not that it's a bad touch. It's that she doesn't know that Bonancia is there.
She does it without really looking. Is that the ball comes across, she takes that first touch, and you can see her then like open up to go get the ball and then realizes, oh no, because there's an Italian player right there. She tries to close. She
the
is
most
not
dangerous
enough.
Player on the Italian team is there.
Yeah. And she loses that 50-50. Bonancia then is on the ball. But I think then you've got basically all of the Australia defense scrambling at that point because it's a turnover not very far from goal. So Kennedy, the left center back, comes flying over to try to make a play. And this is where it's great awareness from Bonancia to spot the heavy touch. It's great awareness and like ability and technical ability and physicality to maintain the ball as she gets past Polkinghorn. Then it's incredible awareness because you would think, oh, here I am, like facing goal. I'm just going to shoot this as fast as I can before the defender gets there. And instead, just a little cut.
Yeah.
And away goes Kennedy, completely out of frame.
She
and Kennedy then it's a good finish.
Better, or was she just forced to scramble so there's no way that she could have... The only way to get there fast enough to close it down was to get there so fast that you risk being cut on.
I would say the second one.
Yeah.
Because it's also worth noting that I forget who, maybe it's Motto, is also there for Italy, is far forward. So I think even if she doesn't like sprint across, if she does slow Bonancia down, then it's going to be a square ball and then an easy finish as well.
Oh, and it's exactly what Bonancia wants as well. Because like in the preview, I looked a lot of her and she's a lot of... Start on the left, cut in on my right foot.
Yep.
So this is like the dream scenario for Bonancia.
Yeah, and it absolutely is. But I think it's also a little bit of like my concern and our concern about Australia heading into this tournament was on display, because Bonatea thinks she puts Italy up very early in the game, like 8th or 9th minute, I think.
Yeah, she's marginally offside.
She's marginally offside, but it's a good reminder that Australia are going to go for it. They're going to be aggressive trying to get goals. That means they're going to leave themselves exposed. Maybe they're going to be a little bit like switch off in defense and maybe take a heavy touch, but also they're going to play a very high line.
And I think it was also notable that it's 1-1, coming towards the end. Australia definitely look unhappy with a draw. They are pushing numbers forward. Mm-hmm. They are sort of desperate to get the ball back. And I think it's that kind of scrambling that eventually leads to Australia conceding that goal.
Yes, I would agree with that. Because it's they've committed numbers forward. Then they kind of get countered on. So then it's a 3-v.
They take a yellow, don't they, as well?
Yes, they do. Yeah, in the build-up. Yeah, that's right. There's a body. I forget who it is. But then it gets played down into the channel, and then it's a 3 Australians on 1 Italian, and that's where the free kick comes about. But the very telling thing there is that it's 3 Australians fighting as hard as they can to win the ball back, which is sort of like when it's 1-1, and maybe you don't want to concede a foul there, it shows you that they're trying to win that ball to go back down and get the win.
And it's I just looked it up. It's Giacinti, who the substitute right back who comes on. So kind of nice idea from the Italy coach to get fresh legs on, I think. So Giacinti is all the way. Am I pronouncing that correctly? It's C-I. Do I go Giacinti or Giacinti?
Oh, I'm not sure.
Oh, let's say Giacinti.
Sure.
And like you said, it's Ellen Knight, right, who is grabbing her arm, and then two other players coming.
I think it's a hard C if not a double C. So yeah, I'm going to say Giacinti.
So yeah, they're grabbing her arm. Two other players come over. They're desperate to get the ball back. Yep. They give away that free kick down there.
Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about what happens in this sequence, because I think Sam Kerr is going to get blamed a little bit because she is kind of stumbling backwards, tries to get ahead to it, cannot, and Bonatea
beats her to it.
Ends up scoring.
So she got posterized, basically.
Yes, and I would say
unfairly
being the main thing there, because to me this is, if not 100%, then close to 100% on Lydia Williams, the Australian goalkeeper.
Yes. So we see her, you notice she sort of cleared out the markers from the near post.
Yes.
I think thinking, this ball is going to drop near post, I'm going to claim it.
Yes, or at least be in an area and be hit low enough that I can come off my line quickly and collect it between the near post and like the penalty spot roughly. And so that's why she clears them out first, and then the first step she takes is towards the free kick.
Uh-huh.
And I guess it's not like the worst idea if that's a thing that you observed and maybe, okay, you're just trying to make a play to be proactive. But it also indicates that it's an aggressive goalkeeper who's going to come for it no matter what. And so to me, it's an example of a goalkeeper who just wants to try to get there, wants to make a play on the ball, but isn't necessarily thinking about where the players are, who the threats are, what she should be doing. So she steps, and then basically you can watch her just kind of run in an arc and ends up trying to make a play on it, but really is just more so hopefully and hopelessly diving for the ball.
There's a lot of indecision, right? Or there's a lot of bad decisions. The decision to step towards the free kick.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the decision to, I'm going to go and claim it at the back post. And then halfway there, she decides, there's no way I'm getting that.
Nope.
Instead, I'm going to like stand here. And then she goes down.
Yep.
Right? And eventually it's Bonancia with a free-ish header. Sam Kerr is with her, but I feel like Sam Kerr is put off by the goalkeeper, Williams.
Lydia Williams. I think so.
Is that fair?
But I think it's also that Australia,
because she thinks Williams is coming, so maybe Kerr like is a little less aggressive than she would.
I'm going to guess there's a big shout from Lydia Williams because she is very aggressive, it seems. But I would also say that it does seem like Australia are in a hybrid zone system, and I think that Sam Kerr is having to backpedal to try to make a play on this. Shows you that maybe something has gone wrong, because if you're doing a zone, you want to attack that ball as quickly as you can, not back up into it.
And Australia should be winning this ball, because I think I counted 8 Australian defenders versus either 4 or 5 Italian attackers.
Yeah,
I want to say like 4 pressed up high and maybe 1 just lurking at the top of the box.
Yeah.
This really should have been Australia's to win. I think a lot of the credit actually goes to Chinoa, the Italian player who took the free kick and bent it to that far post, because definitely Williams' mistake, right? But Chinoa forces her into that mistake by hanging up that ball nicely to the back post.
And puts it in a spot that would have been kind of corridor of uncertainty anyway, because it's back post, but it's high, but it's far enough away from the goal that there's going to be traffic to deal with. And I think it's a well-hit free kick. I would say maybe like little tiny sliver of optimism for Australia. Callan Knight, who is a very kind of dedicated holding midfielder for them, did not start this game. I guess is recovering from injury, so has been having
Is that why she didn't start?
Minutes managed, but she comes in as a substitute, and I'm guessing
and gives away that free kick.
Yeah, there's that. So maybe from a starting position, like in the next game, she'll do better, and Australia still have it all to play for.
All right, so Italy, with that win, are only in second in Group C with that 2-1 win.
Yeah.
Because Brazil.
Because Brazil
got that 3-0 win over Jamaica.
Yes.
Even without the injured Mata. No matter. This is the Cristiane hat-trick that we mentioned earlier with the FBref.com ad read. She came up against Schneider.
Yep.
Schneider made a lot of saves, including an early save and then a penalty save.
How about Jamaica starting a 19-year-old? Like a surprise start. Like I think that was decided like overnight.
Yeah,
Schneider goes in goal.
That's what I heard. And she did have like a really standout game, but I think the fact she had to have a standout game is really illustrative of how dominant Brazil were in this game.
Yes, and I would say Brazil looked very sharp, looked very good, looked very aggressive.
Right? Surprisingly, because we'd heard all this bad stuff about them coming into the tournament, like they've lost 9 in a row, this, that, and the other.
I don't know if this is Brazil figuring it out and being very strong, or if this is Jamaica being particularly weak.
The youngest team in the tournament?
And also pretty open. Yes, youngest, but they also seemed like willing to throw numbers forward at times when then Brazil were able to capitalize upon that. And it also felt like Brazil absolutely dominated that midfield with Formiga and Issa.
Yeah.
Just locking it down.
We spotted at least two of the goals, or was it the penalty that was saved and one of the goals, was essentially Formiga would just sit in the middle of the park, balls would pop loose because Jamaica would be forced into panicked clearances, and she would just so cleanly bring the ball down, put it back in play. Or if one of them's a header, right? It's just a firm header, nod it back into play. She was just very quick and decisive and clean and technical in just recycling that ball into really dangerous positions really quickly.
Yeah.
Don't underestimate Formiga. She's 41. She doesn't need to run. Because she can sit there and make things happen.
She can run, though. I mean, in the lead up to the second goal, she I think, like, wins the ball back in Brazil's half and then wins the ball again. She can make those, darting runs. Formiga is not one to be messed with, even if I forget what the exact number was, but a significant number of the players on the Jamaica roster were not born when Formiga made her first appearance in a Women's World Cup.
Which was 1995,
probably.
I believe. Yeah, I think I saw a stat with her standing next to the numbers of all the World Cups she's been. It was 95, 99, 2003, 2007, 2011, 2015, 2019. Is that seven?
That's seven.
There we go.
That's a significant number.
That's a lot. It's a lot of World Cups.
That's more than I've been in.
Oh, Formiga.
But it's probably not Formiga who's going to be the hero of this game. I would say it's probably going to be Cristiane.
Yes.
Given that, as I've already said, she is current leading
goal scorer.
Contender for the Golden Boot. Yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So Wendy Renard's going to get the Golden Head.
Yes.
And Cristiane is getting the Golden Boot right now.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a cross from your friend, Andressa Alves.
Yep.
You noticed Cristiane does a very nice move on number 14, Blackwood.
Yes, who is the left back and I think is trying to like deputize because Jamaica have kind of all pushed over to one side.
Yep.
But all she does, it's just a little bit of like, she uses her hip just a teeny tiny bit to get a little bit of separation to body off Blackwood and then just powerful header. But from...
It's the classic experience versus inexperience move, right? The hip check. I've seen like older players do this to younger players a lot. I'm not saying Cristiane is an older player, but compared to Blackwood, she is. Just the experience of knowing a little hip check will throw you completely off balance. It will give me the full advantage.
It will. But then it's also the veteran finish because...
Yes.
Like 8 yards out thereabouts, I think, on the header, maybe a little bit further back than that even. It's just the power she gets behind it coupled with the direction. It's a really like well-struck but well-placed headed goal. And it is all the kind of component parts of a very, very lethal goal scorer.
Oh, okay. You're going to have to talk me through the second goal because I cannot remember how Cristiane scores the second goal.
Sure. Well, do you want to go to that or do you want to go to the penalty? Because it's worth noting, we'll say very briefly, Schneider has a save on a breakaway early in the first half. Then she pulls off the save on, I believe, Andressa Alves, my player that
penalty
I spotlighted.
Kick. Yeah.
Sai.
Not a good penalty. I think she kind of like scuffed a bit of the floor on the way in.
Yes. But then I wouldn't say Schneider's necessarily at fault for the second goal. She has a part to play in it because basically it's another ball in.
I remember it now.
It's another ball in from Andressa Alves and basically Schneider and I forget who the defender. Plummer. Plummer is the one who basically they both think the other one's going to get it. They both kind of pull out a little bit. It goes between them, goes to the back post where
Cristiane's just sliding in, right?
Exactly. She's happily waiting there and the ball doesn't necessarily look like it 100% goes over the line when you first see it. When you watch the replay, it's definitely over the line.
Isn't that a weird visual trick?
Yes.
Like when you see it live, you're like, oh, she cleared it off the line.
Yeah.
And when you see the replay, it's like so obviously like three yards in the back of the net.
And I do feel for Plummer because it's Plummer who pulls out of that tackle initially, but then continues the run and is the one who almost clears it off the line. So she almost gets to it, but doesn't quite get there in the end.
Oh, and that's 2-0.
Yes.
And then 3-0 is once again Formiga.
Yeah.
So Formiga intercepts in midfield. Mm-hmm. I think she plays a nice little chest pass.
It's interesting that you referred to the third goal, thus the hat trick of Cristiane as all Formiga.
Well, we'll get to the Cristiane part. All right. Formiga with a little like chest pass into, is it Debinha, I think, who then goes on a dribble and is taken down at the top of the box.
No, it's Cristiane. He's taken down.
Is it really?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow. All right. I should give Cristiane more credit.
Yeah, it's Formiga. Formiga wins the ball deep. Then I think she wins it back. Then she plays it into Cristiane. Cristiane goes on the run, which was a kind of hallmark of what Brazil were doing, especially in the second half, was go at that Jamaica defense, make them back off, make them make plays, and either they concede a foul or they all kind of converge and then there's opportunities elsewhere.
Yeah.
Here they all converge and commit a foul at the same time.
And Cristiane steps up and bends this free kick in. There's also questions about Schneider here. Right?
I would say here is where you see maybe the inexperience at this level, where Schneider sets the wall up and then stands like to the open side, I would put it, of the wall, like kind of at the far post, but the wall is supposed to cover the near post. That
and
Cristiane
then shoots the wrong way, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and then basically the ball goes where her like left shoulder would have been if she had jumped up, essentially. Because Schneider, cheats back over the wall. She thinks it's going to be an attempt to go up and over.
Like up and over near post instead of bend it around the wall to go in at the far post.
Yes. Yeah, and so instead
of... overthink it, maybe?
I think so. I think maybe she...
Because it should be set your wall on the near post, you save the far post, right?
Yeah,
and then
but
you're set.
I think it's maybe similar to Williams. It's the feeling of, like, I've got to be up on my toes. I've got to be doing something. Williams for Australia. Like, that I've got to just come off my line and try to make a play. I can't get beat here.
Yeah.
And in trying to do just a little bit extra, you end up doing too much. And so just by cheating a little bit to that one side, you leave the opposite side open. It's another sort of misleading one because it goes, I think, off the underside of the bar, then hits the ground, then goes up and hits the bar again, then comes back down, then gets kind of headed across.
Right?
It is, but it takes a minute for it to be very clear that it's a goal. But it's a goal, and it's a hat trick for Cristiane.
Top scorer so far. And like I said, Brazil are top of Group C with that 3-0 win and 3 points.
Hey, Daryl.
Yeah?
That checks out.
Mm-hmm. All right, so on to Group D.
Yeah.
Where there's only been one game.
Yes.
And it was the oldest game in the history of soccer, England versus Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
We came in hyped up. We were ready for it. Our key didn't work to the office, so we missed the first couple minutes.
We did.
But we made it.
Mm-hmm.
We made it. I'm going to say a mostly convincing win for England.
I'm going to say VAR is an abomination and must be removed from this planet. But yeah, otherwise, sure. Why not?
So this is because England win a penalty early on, right? It's a Frank Kirby cross.
Win is a word.
It's a Frank Kirby cross.
Or gifted.
That hits Doherty in the arm.
Yeah.
Again, like her arm's outstretched. There's no real argument here, right?
No, not at all. And I think it's hurt a little bit. Again, part of it is that we only get the replay like that they're theoretically seeing. I can't imagine that's the only thing that's being shown. Because it does look like maybe it hits her arm, but the way the angle is, it seems like, it hits her arm, but it continues on. It doesn't really alter the trajectory. I guess it should be given, but it still seems harsh. And then you watch the kind of longer replay, and it very clearly blocks the ball.
It dies midair, right?
Yeah, but the kind of like quick replay makes it seem like the ball continues on its way. When you watch the full replay, the ball like dies, basically.
Yep.
Like it ends up stopping maybe 5 yards away as opposed to going to the back post where it would have gone.
And my new favorite player, Nikita Paris, steps up, bangs this penalty, top left corner. This whole English players
penalty,
can't take penalties
friend.
Thing is gone, right? England men beat... Switzerland on penalty kicks today. And Nikita Paris bangs one top left corner in the World Cup.
I would be happier about Nikita Paris's one.
I can be happy about
that
both.
Is,
any English penalty going in is a source of celebration.
That is an emphatic finish on that
it
penalty.
Is, right?
She hits it. She hits it well. She hits it hard. She hits it with like determination. And then she does the full sprint to the bench to celebrate.
Yeah.
I also enjoyed that.
Oh, she did the weird face. Did you call it a John Cena?
You can't see me.
Mm-hmm. You can't see me.
There you go.
So I want to talk about Scotland's approach to this game.
All right.
It was definitely...
Defend with a capital
defend,
D.
Right?
Yes.
It looked like, do you think it's fair to call it like a 4-4-1-1 kind of 4-5-1?
That's what I like from what I saw of them in doing the preview. They seem to be most comfortable in a 4-4-1-1. The thing that I was surprised by is that it was Cuthbert starting up top with Kim Little behind in that 4-4-1-1.
Yeah,
I expected Kim Little to play deeper and be one of like the two central midfielders in the four person midfield.
Because Kim Little, for people who don't know, is like one of the best players in the world.
Yeah.
Great at retaining the ball and moving the ball through midfield.
And what we saw in the first like 30 minutes was basically Kim Little just running around trying to get any sniff of the ball.
Yeah.
But because I think England did a very good job of depriving her of any sort of service, marking her pretty effectively, but because also Kim Little was deployed further up the field, I think she wasn't as involved in what Scotland were doing, which was sitting back and then trying to kind of combine a little bit, but really never being able to combine with Kim Little. And I think if she'd been further back to start, I think that probably helps them retain possession a little bit more and have kind of more coordinated attacks. I kept seeing a lot of like Australia, or like when Scotland would have an attack, it'd be like, Scotland get the ball, Scotland play it wide to the right, Scotland play it a little bit wide to the right. Now they just kick it long because they kind of run out of passing options.
There were never numbers there, right? And England could swarm them as soon as they entered England's half.
Yep.
Am I correct in saying that by playing Cuthbert, who's like their other most attacking player, but actually their most attacking player, right? Because Little's more of a central midfielder.
I wouldn't say that because Ross, the centre forward, is like one of their all-time leading goal scorers.
This is what I'm saying. By playing Cuthbert as the centre forward, they sacrificed a striker who...
I was just objecting to you saying to their best goal scorer.
I see. So I think, but we're agreeing here. Mm-hmm. They dropped their best goal scorer, whose name is Ross, to play Cuthbert up front and Little farther forward so they could essentially play two defensive midfielders in Weir and Murray.
Yeah.
And that was the defensive gamble that absolutely did not come off, especially if you concede a penalty within, the first 15, 14 minutes.
Yes. Yeah. I would have liked to see Jane Ross. I was sad. But I was also sad by the penalty, not just because it meant England got the lead. You know, it's fine.
I don't really care.
But it did.
You did come in singing Flower of Scotland, but...
Was I singing that or was I singing...
Something
I was singing Doogie McLean.
Something bagpipe.
I was singing The Gale, which is a great song. But, which you can't really sing because it's instrumental. But whatever. But it was also the case that, Scotland basically set up to be very defensive, had a defensive game plan. When you go 1-0 down fairly early in the game, that kind of negates that game plan.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. As does a second goal, which certainly doesn't
help. Yeah, what about when you go 2-0 down? So, Ellen White scores in the 40th minute. The finish is beautiful. The 10 seconds before is not beautiful. It's a lot of scrambling, but it's a lot of Scotland stuck in their own box, can't clear. England keep winning it, right? Jill Scott wins like two headers, I think. But the build-up before this to get England from essentially their own left-back spot all the way up into this attacking position is actually some really nice passing football from England.
It is.
Yeah.
That's not what I'm laughing about. I'm laughing that, Daryl, when we went back and watched this, like just before we started recording, you were so very hopeful that this goal came from England building
it
up.
To be a flowing move. Yeah. It was. Two-thirds of it was.
The look of sadness when England did cough up possession and Scotland were able to get clear, because you were like, maybe.
Because it goes from left back, I think Greenwood, all the way through both central midfielders. Jill Scott lays it off. It goes out right. It comes back in the middle. Jill Scott's in the box at this point, and I think she just kind of lifts it in. She tries like a lob cross type thing to, I think, White, and it doesn't come off. And that's when Scotland head it away, and that's when the scrambling starts.
Yes.
And then there's like another header, top of the box. And then is it Greenwood that eventually steps up?
Yes, it is.
And wins the Scottish clearance?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, it is. The confusing thing is that she wins it, but then it, like, there's some, I'm kind of confused as to who actually gets a touch to the ball
it's
before.
Corsi versus Kirby, right?
Yes,
so
it is.
So it's England's playmaker versus Scotland's captain and best defender.
Yeah, and I think...
I'm not sure either of them touch it, or they both touch it.
I think Kirby ends up getting the only kind of touch to the ball, but I think they're both so focused on running at the ball at 100%, but also maybe not then clattering into each other because that could be injury, possibly a penalty, possibly a free kick. So they're both sort of adjusting
to it. Kirby had taken a knock earlier, right?
Yeah.
So she's maybe been a bit careful.
And so I don't think Kirby even necessarily means to get the touch that she gets. I think certainly she's trying to get a touch, but the way it ends up kind of perfectly going into the path of White to get the finish, I'm going to say fortuitous, but she'll happily take the assist.
But a perfect finish from White, right? Did
100%.
She bend it like to the left, but around and into the bottom corner?
Yep.
It is an absolutely superb finish. Any thought that I had that maybe Jodie Foster should be starting, I think Jodie Foster, that's not correct. Jodie Taylor
there you go.
Should be starting, I think, was undone by White's finish.
Dr. Lecter. yes, Jodie Foster should not be starting. But I enjoyed watching Ellie White in this one, especially in the lead up to this goal, because she is doing a lot of the just little things you want your center striker to be doing, especially in the box. She's occupying defenders, she's making sure they're kind of focused on her, but then she keeps trying to find space. You can see her kind of keep adjusting. She's never just standing watching what's happening.
Yeah.
And I think as a result, that's why she's up on her toes and able to basically just swivel and hit that ball and have such a good finish. So it's a credit to her, and you're totally wrong.
Final point about England, I think I still think Nikita Paris is the player to watch. Mm-hmm. Even in the we forgot to mention this, when Kirby wins the penalty with the cross, it's Paris who's done a little move at the top of the box to open things up. There were also some moments where she, I can't remember what it was like a weird sort of receive the ball on the touchline, outside of the foot, swivel, run around, like, where she absolutely destroyed a Scottish defender.
If you want to do some scrolling back, go to Aaron West's timeline and scroll back to this game, and you'll see England megged it might have been Cuthbert twice, but there are three megs on Scottish players in 30 seconds,
ooh,
culminating in the one you're talking about when Nikita Paris does like the little outside of the foot. She megs a player, goes around her, and gets it on the other side.
It's, yeah.
It's not fun when you're the defender and that happens to you. Not that I would ever know, but maybe I have. And maybe that attacking player got their leg swept as a result.
And to repeat that, mm-hmm. Aaron West is definitely worth a follow during this
Absolutely.
World Cup. He's over in Paris.
He is.
He's working for Fox. Mm-hmm. He's also just tweeting out great, fun Women's World Cup content all day, every day.
Yes.
Yeah.
And a husband of Yael Averbush, who yes. I think you were telling me that they play Megs in their house. Is that right?
I saw a thing where Yael Averbush said, I haven't taken a full stride in my house in years.
Oh boy, that game gives me such anxiety. I'm so happy we don't play it in this office.
Right? Yeah, yes. I think we set a good precedent by not doing it.
I think like once or twice I've forgotten and like started to try to play it, and then we're just instantly like, I'm sorry, no, I didn't mean it. I don't want to do this. I don't want to go down this road.
We'll stick to soccer tennis in the hallway. Yes, right?
But maybe that's what's holding us back from being able to compete at World Cup level is not playing Mets, because clearly the England players play it, and thus they're always looking for it, and thus they can pull it off.
That must be it. Mm-hmm. So they don't win 2-0.
They do not.
Scotland do get one back, mm-hmm. but it's kind of late, and is it Scotland essentially step up and apply a bit more pressure,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
They come out of their shell a little bit.
They do. I think they make a few more attacking subs. They get like more bodies into positions where they can then kind of battle a bit more with England. Yeah, they end up going at England, putting them under pressure. And
Steph Houghton, who's trying to play out of the back and just plays it directly to a Scottish player. I'm actually not sure.
I mean, what kind of England performance would it be if your central defender and captain didn't give the ball away to opposition to get a goal?
A better one. So Emsley gets the goal in what, like the late 70s, I believe, 1979.
Yep. Yes, exactly, 1979.
79th minute is when Emsley scores. Yep. But England kind of have it on lockdown after that. It's okay.
Should we talk about gamesmanship for a moment?
Oh, yes. Lucy Bronze.
Yes.
With the best moment of the game.
It's some cockycaffery. It definitely is.
It is, right? Yes. So yeah, Emsley has the ball in the back of the net. Mm-hmm. What Scottish players want to do, and what any team that's scored... they're a goal closer, they're still a goal down, there's 10 minutes left, you want to get that ball, you want to get it back to the halfway line, you want the momentum to continue, you want the game to kick off so you can continue. Lucy Bronze makes sure to pick up the ball herself and slowly, very slowly walk it out the back of the net.
Also falls over. That's the other
one. Oh, does she?
Because she gets the ball first, and then as the Scotland, I think Cuthbert is the one trying to get it back from her, she falls over and acts like she's been, maybe she has been shoved, I don't know, but now she's tangled in the net, and that slows it up even more.
Yeah.
So it's some crafty work by her, and I think she also hangs onto the ball as well while falling over.
And then when the ref, it is Cuthbert, or I think it's Cuthbert, is complaining, Bronze is just saying to the ref, it's our ball, and the ref kind of eventually accedes to that, because you kind of have to, because it is England's ball.
It's a strange thing.
It's England's job to take it to the halfway line and kick it off, however quickly or slowly they want to.
You're not supposed to go in after it. That's the thing. Like, we've had that in some of our games where like we'll score a goal and everyone's like, go get the ball. I'm like, no.
Oh, I got into a wrestling match with the goalkeeper once.
I know, exactly.
And I had to eventually accept that, it's his ball. I can't do anything.
Yeah, exactly. And I remember like that happened to me once and I felt completely the aggrieved party.
Yeah.
And then when the referee was like, no, you're not supposed to go after the ball. It's tough in a moment to be told, no, you're the one who's in the wrong.
Good smarts from Lucy Bronze. Mm. Good smarts.
May I tell you one more thing that continues to confuse me about England?
If I say no, will you still tell me?
I will. Kim McCauley is the one who tweeted this one, but it's a thing that has been throwing me every single time you did the preview and mentioned her name. Do you know Jill Scott, the R&B singer? Or like soul singer, sort
no.
of? Yeah, she's an American soul singer, African-American woman, and every time, and looks... She does not look like Jill Scott, who plays for England, who is maybe like 100 pounds and is like 6 foot
tall.
She's
tall and skinny, basically.
It's just every single time you're like, I'm like, Jill Scott's on the team. What's his name? She's playing for the U.S. Women's National Team. This is unacceptable.
I'm glad that name confusion could end.
It really does.
All right, so that's 6 Women's World Cup games that we just covered in 40 minutes.
Yep,
not bad.
Nah,
2 more games tomorrow. So
thanks, coffee.
Thanks, coffee. Yeah. We'll be back on Monday, and we will have a look at Monday's games, first of all, which are, let me know, Taylor. It's definitely Argentina-Japan, right?
It's definitely Argentina-Japan.
Because that's the other Group D game.
And then it's Canada-Cameroon. Argentina-Japan is at noon, I believe, and then Canada-Cameroon, 3 p.m.
So I just checked, and you are correct.
You can sleep in a little bit tomorrow morning.
So my guess... So I was very disrespectful to Argentina in the preview because I saw their defending was not great. I know Japan's a younger team, right? It's not the 2015 or 2011 team.
It is not.
I still would expect Japan to really take it to Argentina. And then Canada-Cameroon, I think it'd be interesting just to watch this Canada team.
I think the first 15 minutes of Argentina-Japan is going to be especially interesting because I do think Japan, I think they were still figuring some things out heading into this tournament. They're also not a team that scores once they go behind. So if Argentina can get on them and get after them early, that kind of could maybe dictate the way this game
early
goes.
Early solo Jaime header. could make all the difference.
There we are. Yeah. And then Canada-Cameroon. I'm just excited because I have not watched nearly as much Canada as I probably should have at this point. Especially, and I say that having done the preview, I watched plenty. But I would like to watch more of them, especially in a competitive game, especially given that they are, I would say, one of the tournament favorites.
I'm interested in watching Jesse Fleming's passing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep, yep, yep.
Okay, so both those games tomorrow, but also the USA.
Yep.
Plays their first game against Thailand. It's on Tuesday. So on Monday, we will have a full preview of USA v Thailand. All that to come on tomorrow's Total Soccer Show.
Hooray, soccer.
Should we wrap it up for today, though, Taylor?
I suppose we should.
All right, then I'll say, Taylor Rockwell, thank you for taking the time to talk to me today.
Right back at you, buddy.
Listeners, thank you for listening, and we'll talk to you again on Monday.